Before we get started, I'm going to reiterate. I'm going to first thank everybody. I want to thank Debbie and Shoshana and Matthew and David Brommer who run the event space. It's a fantastic venue for you, right? This is a free event. You get to see a lot of great photographers as long as it fits your schedule. And it's really a wonderful place to come. I love it here. I want to thank Peter Levitt. He is sitting in the back. He is the Expo Imaging Rogue Flashbender representative in this neighborhood. Our model, Rochelle. Rochelle is a professional, and we work a lot together. She'd be here for us today. I chose her, or actually we kind of got together on this, because I think she looks like a 40s glamour star. I think she looks like Hedy Lamarr. So when we start taking the photos, you'll be able to see how close she looks to Hedy Lamarr. Anybody know that name? Yeah? Yeah, no, you know it, man. I'm going to mention her because I really became enamored with her when I began the research for this. I began to shoot this style of look about 4 years ago. I got a little bored. When you're a photography educator and you set up an umbrella and tell everybody this is how you do your job with an umbrella, after 4 years, the umbrella gets a little old. So you want to try something new. I'm always looking for new things, always looking for new ways to light, to present, to teach, to shoot in my own work. So I began shooting this about 4 years ago. I didn't do a lot of research on it until we decided to run this program. When I did a lot of research, and I actually have a small bibliography on the slideshow. So we're going to get started right now with the slideshow. It's not long, but there's some great information on it. Again, what I'm trying to do for 2014 is slow everything down. So I'll do the slideshow, then we'll do a small question and answer session. Then we'll start shooting, and I'll tell you how I do it, okay? One of the things that I will tell you that I did find while doing this research was that all the videos and information that I found, everybody either used strobe lighting or hot lighting. I didn't find a single person doing this with speed lighting, and not speed lighting the way that I do it, okay? I think my results are really classic looking to the genre. And I really like to pay homage to the genre because it's really amazing. And you can see a lot of that technique even in today's photography, okay? Okay, so welcome to B&H Photo Event Space. This is the 40s Hollywood Glamour presentation. I will also be shooting and showing you how the whole thing works. It'll go right into my laptop, I'll shoot tethered, and you'll see what happens. A little bit about me first. If you've not taken a workshop or a presentation with me, my name is Robert Harrington. You can call me Bob. Robert Harrington Studios is my website and company. My blog is at wordpress.com. If you follow me, there's a ton of information on small flash photography. Everything from the three light corporate portrait to gels, creative lighting, all kinds of crazy fun stuff. My Twitter account's Bob Harrington too. My Facebook is Robert Harrington, although I'm rarely on Facebook. My email, this is crucial. If you want a copy of the slideshow for your own records, so you can go back and reference photos and names that are on the slideshow, send me an email and I will send you back a PDF, okay? If I don't respond to you in about a week, resend me an email and I will get back to you with a PDF. Okay, I am an author as well. My book, Photographic Lighting by Ammonite Press, is available on Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and I think they have it here, I'm not sure. I have a smaller book that I wrote and self-published on blurb.com called One Speed Light, 16 Looks, which is one light source, 16 different ways, which is really pretty cool, especially if you're a beginner or if you're an advanced shooter looking to just expand your knowledge base on lighting. There's some great and fun techniques in there. I also freelance write for Shutterbug magazine. Our sponsors for today are Expo Imaging, makers of the Rogue Flashbender system, and Photix, makers of the radio triggers that I'll be using today. Without them, none of this would be possible. I also work with Totally Rad Actions. We'll be using them later on when we choose a final image and I begin to process it. I'll show you how I process these photos out, okay, from start to finish. Our lighting gear for today, pardon me. I find it always important to reiterate what I'm using because so many people are always shopping for either something new to get started with or to replace something that they have that may break. I'm using Nikon SB910 as my key light and two SB800s as my hair and backlight. They're attendant battery packs, SD9 and SD8As. The 800s and their battery packs are no longer manufactured. You have to purchase them used on a used site. I'm using a small Rogue flash bender rolled into a snoot. This is really one of the benefits of this system. You have a diffusion screen. You pull the screen off. You have a reflective panel, okay? And you can also roll this thing into a snoot. And that's how I shoot this look. This will be my key light today, all right? I use a large Rogue flash bender rolled into a snoot as my hair light and a Rogue grid for the background. Gear for today continued. My radio triggers are Photix Odin. The Odin is a TTL-based system that you can also work all your flashes in manual mode. And I'll work all of my flashes in manual mode today. I use Manfrotto 105-2 BAC light stands with Lumo Pro LP633 umbrella brackets and Ansman 2850 milliamp batteries. I love these batteries. I own about 100 of them, and they give me really great service. I shot a workshop on Sunday, and we probably took 900 to 1,000 photographs before I had to start changing my batteries out. Okay, the studio system. This is where some of the research comes in. I found this very interesting. The Glamour Portrait comes about in around 1930, okay? And it comes about during the time of the Great Depression. And a lot is happening within the country. So the studio system is actually a consolidation of the movie and the entire movie industry. This particular era lasts from 1930 to 1946 about. This is the high time. This is the golden age of movie making. The studio system standardized the movie industry. They invented the Saturday double feature. Okay, so in 1933, when people have no money for anything, they can still scrape up, you know, so it was 5 and 10 cents, whatever it costs to go see a double feature and escape reality for the afternoon, okay? At this point, the Hollywood Glamour Portrait is really coming to the fore as a social kind of thing, in that the actors and actresses are glamorized to the point of being gods and goddesses, right? And people are looking up to them, not rebelling against their wealth, but looking up to them saying, you know, we're in the depth of this Great Depression, but I still have the ability, I can aspire to be that. It's really a great social medium, especially because it's involved with photography. You see the rise of the newsreel, the cartoons, and the serials. Like I did some research, Flash Gordon, right, Buck Rogers, stuff like that. There's a couple others, I forgot what they were. Commander Cody, I think, was one of them. All right, the studio system replaces artistic freedom and with predictable results. So you would go to the movies on Saturday and you would know that the good guy always won, right? The cowboy never lost his hat, right? The good guy, the bad cowboy with the black hat, he always lost it in the end. All right, this is crucial to their success. The Glamour Portraits brought about to elevate the stars to a symbolic stature, and also the studios began to use this kind of portraiture as a screen test. Instead of bringing an actress or actor in for a screen test, they would send them to the photographer. And if the photographer said that they worked well in front of the light and the camera, then they were then given a shot. Okay, if the photographer said, or the photos came out bad, they would say, nope, next. All right, so they wouldn't waste any time with film and waste their time with a screening or any kind of casting. This, I thought, was incredibly important, the photographers. I have two slides here for you with a bunch of names. Because if you Google Hollywood Glamour Portrait, who do you come up with? Anybody?
Harrell.
George Harrell. You Google Gene Harlow, who comes up? George Harrell. You Google Hedy Lamarr, who comes up? George Harrell. Clark Gable? George Harrell. This is not to belittle his influence on the entire genre. What I wanted to do was find other photographers, right? He is not the only guy taking photographs for all these studios. And you have to remember, there's a lot of other studios and independent operations that are doing the same thing. So you have George Harrell, he was with MGM. Clarence Sinclair Bull, MGM. Ruth Harriet Louise, which was the rare female of the bunch, she worked for MGM. Laszlo Willinger, who I thought was very interesting. I found a YouTube interview with him. He had photographed Norma Jean for quite a long time before she became Marilyn Monroe. I thought that was very, very interesting. Bill Walling with Paramount Universal. Edwin Bauer with Hesser, with Warner Brothers. Ernest Bachrach with RKO. And it goes on. I couldn't believe how many photographers there actually were working in the studio system and in this genre. Otto Dyer with Paramount, Elmer Fryer with Warner Brothers, Kenneth Alexander with United Artists, Ray Jones with Columbia, Bert Six with Warner Brothers, and Gene Corman with 20th Century Fox. So you have a lot of different studios within the system, a lot of different photographers working with this kind of look. What separates the other looks from the Hollywood look? Black and white, right? We're in the era of black and white. When you see a Hollywood portrait done in color, you're kind of taken aback. It's kind of like, that doesn't really look right, until you turn it to black and white and you're like, oh, there's the contrast, there's the hard light, there's the look. Focused, hard, deep shadows, right? You'll see very hard shadows under the chin, the nose, the eyelashes. The eyelashes will shadow underneath here, okay? Loop light, Paramount light, and flat light. So three unique lighting scenarios that were used and are identified with this particular look. Also, you have a sharp initial image with improvements in lens and film technology for the 8x10 camera. Most of this, or nearly all of it, was shot with an 8x10 camera, okay, under hot lights. Right? So if you have a big tungsten hot light blaring down on somebody, okay, if you improve the film, you get more detail. Okay, with more detail means you can work with more of the photograph on the negative, which is just like digital. If you shoot in RAW, you have more detail to work with, right? With improvements in lenses, cameras, and film technology, the images are sharper. The retouching. They did the same thing that we do today, except we do it on a computer. They did it on the negative. They would scrape and scratch and remove things that didn't belong there, right? Smooth out the skin, take some hair out. They would do some airbrushing. They would lay textures, right? Dodge and burn when they did the final print, okay? Their negatives sometimes looked so bad that they would actually duplicate the negative, all right? They would photograph it again. And then that would be the negative that they would work on more or send out for print. You'll notice blown highlights in the hair, okay? A lot of overexposure back here, all right? Especially on blondes, like Jean Harlow. You see a photo of Jean Harlow. All the detail here is gone. It is just this bright halo, okay? That dreamy, alluring look-away shot, all right? The actor or actress is looking like this, okay? If I'm Clark Gable, I'm looking for Hedy Lamarr. And hey, I'm Hedy Lamarr, I'm looking for Clark Gable, okay? You also have the dreamy, alluring into the camera shot, which I found to be amazing because when I did a lot of the research, all the photos seemed to be looking away. And that's what everybody said, there's always a look away. But then I start looking at all the images from all the actors and actresses. And there's a lot of them where they're looking into the camera. They're looking right into the camera, right? I'm looking right into my audience. I'm still dreamy and alluring, but I'm looking into my audience. Another characteristic is the simple background to the graphic background to something a little more complex. You'll see in the beginning, a lot of white walls are washed off with just a third light. All right, you have a key light, a hair light, and a third light washing down the wall. Then they add a cuculoris or put a tree or a bush or something in front of that light and put a pattern on the back wall, all right? Then you have, later on, you have graphics, you have walls, you'll have columns and pilasters, you look like the subject is in the room or in something greater than themselves. Then you have the complex background or the graphic where there's a famous photo of Kirk Douglas where he's literally tugging on a rope like this. He's tugging. There's tension in the photograph. There's more growth from that alluring, looking for whoever, to something more with some more drama and a dramatic character in it. Okay, the magic numbers. When I shoot this look, I normally keep my camera shutter speed at 1/125th of a second, my aperture at 5, 6 to 8, and my ISO 200. I like a little more depth of field to work with. I would like to have more sharp in the image and then soften it out later. This is just the way I shoot it. If you find that you don't want to do that, you want to shoot it at f4 or at 2.8, you know what, that's up to you. I like to have more detail, and then I can take it out later on, especially with clothing. Because a lot of these photos, you know, clothing still looks sharp. Looks sharp. Even though the face and everything has been softened, the clothing still looks sharp. So I'm thinking they're probably shooting maybe 5, 6, or 8, depending on the lights that they're using. I was unable to discover any exposure readings for any of the photos. I spent a small amount of time trying to find that and was unable to get any of that. I set my white balance usually to daylight. If you have to, you can take a custom white balance, but I normally set it to daylight for this look. It's a very neutral to slightly cool tone, which helps later on when you go to black and white. My key light is in manual mode at 1/4 power, and my hair and background lights are manual mode at 1/4 power. I start everything off even, and I know, depending on my subject to light distance, that's about where I want to be for 5.6 to 8 aperture. Okay, if I have to, I can adjust up or down as I need to. Okay, I took this shot in my studio. I did a range of shots with this particular model. And this is emblematic of the style, right? It has almost everything in it. We have that low contrast black and white. We have loop light underneath her right nose. See that? See that? That's indicative of loop light, right? With that hard nose shadows coming down here. Shadows hard underneath her chin. Everything's falling. Look at the shadow underneath her eyelashes. It literally looks like something's been added here, okay? On the back wall is just a third light lighting up the back wall, and that's about it, okay? So I have a key light, a hair light, and a back light. This is the same sitting, we just changed the background. I put her in front of a drape, and that's it. And I skimmed light across the drape to give me some of that edge detail across the back. My key light is nearly facing her straight on, so it's utterly flat light. We have a very small shadow under her nose, which is really being lit directly. And the hair light is off to the left, and you can see it just at the top of her hair and skimming across. So we have another three lights set up, okay? I went more to the graphics of this genre a little bit later on, all right? I put a black card up, a black flat up. My key light, see the loop shadow, see the shadow underneath her right nose? See how strong and hard and loopy it is? All right, it's a little beyond a typical loop light. My hair light's hitting her on the right side and then skimming across and hitting the black card. So that's a single light source giving me hair light and that, that semicircular edge light on the black card. And on the back, I have a grid going through blinds that I just set up and send some light through the blinds to give me that third element. And she just stood there and looked like that, and boom. Our last look I took from Veronica Lake. There's a beautiful Veronica Lake photograph. Again, a loop light, okay? My hair light is skimming across the top right of her hair. Everything's slightly overexposed on the foreground here, and I have a grid going through. You ever see one of those seamstress? It's like a body, but it's all like steel framework. I actually have a behind-the-scenes shot of this one, and this is my small studio back home. And I have a Nikon SB900 at the time with a small Rogue flashbender rolled into a snoot as my key. My hair is a large Rogue flashbender. The grid is shooting through that that seamstress like mannequin thing. You actually see the double shadow on the door. I wound up putting a black flag there to keep any light from hitting the back wall and then bouncing forward, because the walls were, at this time, the walls were like a tan color. And it not only would have affected overall color tone, but it would have added extra light. I didn't want that, so I just flagged it off. But if you see that in color, you're kind of thrown off. In color, you're kind of like, whoa, it's really not what I'm thinking I'm seeing here. This is my friend Bernadette. If anybody's been with me before and shot with Bernadette, this is her. We shot this here in New York, and very simple, elegant look. She's on a chaise, right? She has that look. She's looking for, I don't know, Clark Gable, Cary Grant. What do you guys think? This was taken only a few years ago, so maybe Brad Pitt, I don't know. Here's our setup, all right? This is more to the taste of what you would have seen back in the day. A larger studio space, all right, three lights going. If you Google any of the photographers that I gave you on this slideshow and you look at some of them, sometimes you'll see a behind the scenes shot. It's kind of rare. I found a few of them. And they're all working closely. Literally, the light is utterly on top of the subject. The camera is right here in front of the subject. Everything's close in. But this would be the setup, a key, a hair, and a backlight. The backlight is a rogue grid, and I'm shooting it through those French doors to give me that pattern on the wall. And that's a gobo or go-between, or maybe a kookalorus, or a cookies, okay? I created that effect with a third light. Here she is again, this is in my studio. This is a little more to the glamour side, right? She has that faraway look, that dreamy, alluring, faraway look, okay? Here's Paramount light. Look at the shadow under her nose. That's Paramount light, where that shadow is utterly reflecting itself right here. This I shot up in upstate Connecticut. I was running a workshop and she came in dressed like that. I had no idea she was coming looking like that at all whatsoever. And I saw her and I said, okay, have a seat, we have to do this because you just look like a Hollywood movie star. She sat in the chair, I set up my lights, I took the color shot. I like the color shot. You guys? Mm-hmm. It's pretty good. I thought it was really good. She's just, you know, she's gorgeous. She had the ruby red lipstick, the whole thing. I went to black and white. I liked it better. Yeah. Okay, I just thought it was way just beyond too classic. And here's the setup. So we're in a big kind of convention, not a convention hall, but like a hall, like a VFW or something. I have a backdrop up. My key light is right in front of her, okay, aiming down. You'll notice that a lot of the angles that these photographers are using aren't the normal 45 by 45 portrait. A lot of their angles are high and angled down. They bring their light up high, angle it down steep, and then bring their subject into it, okay? My hair light's in the back, skimming across the top of her head, and my rogue grid's lighting up that little spot just behind her head. There she is laughing, we're having a good time. That's a better shot of how the setup. Okay, you actually see everything going on. She is a trip, she was a lot of fun. And very amenable to the look. I shot this at WPPI last year in the trade show booth. If anybody's going to WPPI, it's coming up this weekend. Her name is Leticia. She was fantastic, and she really had the look going. She had that dreamy, alluring, far away kind of, looking for something beyond that she just was going for. I really enjoyed working with her. She was fabulous. And if you look at the key, right, the hair, the light's falling down, all of the folds in her hair or the curls in her hair, the top is actually blown out a little bit, all right? That's indicative of the look. You're killing highlights, all right? But not on the face, not on the skin, on the hair. I shot this in Wisconsin in a camera store. And I was running a workshop in Wisconsin, and it would utterly be like all of us in this room working out there. That's what it was like. It was a working camera store. There were people traveling in and out, watching what we were doing. The slat wall behind her was actually covered in stuff. I just pulled some of the product off the wall, moved it to the other side of the room. This shows graphics, right? There is hard-edge graphics behind her and has tension. Her body is going one way and the graphics are going the other, all right? And that's literally in the store. I'm telling you, it'd be like just walking out the door and going to work, She came with that hat. It's like, oh my God, this is amazing. I shot this in my studio. I take chances sometimes in processing. I just don't go to straight black and white and then boost contrast a little bit. Here I did a kind of a cooler, bluer tone. I liked it at the time. Right now I'm kind of iffy on it. I don't know about you guys. But it's also a very good example of Paramount light. All right, look at the light under her nose, Paramount or butterfly light, all right? My key light's high and above, and it's hitting her straight on. I have a hair light skimming across the top of her hair, and one light skimming across the back on the drape, and the drape is showing all the high points of the drape, and that's giving us a nice background. Here's a little more modern take on it. I shot this in Philadelphia, and you can see the three lights, right? She had a more modern dress, modern jewelry, modern haircut, all right? But I liked the fact that I decided to take this shot to the next level and bring it to this look. It's not too classic looking, but I like the fact that I went to black and white, and now we have kind of you can see a more modern take on the classic look. This, of course, is Rochelle. We shot this about 2 years ago. It was a long time ago. This was great. This is a three light setup, right? This is flat light, all right? She has a very short shadow underneath her nose, not too deep. She turned one way or the other, it would turn to a deep shadow or almost no shadow. So it's almost complete flat light. I have a hair light and I have a background light. And I photographed this in front of a black piece of foam core board. And that was it. And it was dirty and nasty and everything. But because it had been well worn. But the grid gave me that nice spotlight behind her head. You can see some of the dirtiness and the nastiness on it. It's almost dimpled or stippled like a muslin. And it came out great. That was one of my favorite shots. You can see how the shadows fall underneath her chin, under her lower lip, right? You have this definition of shadow on the cheeks coming down here. Because the light's hitting so hard and direct, it's coming this way and falling off immediately. You don't have to have three lights to do this look. This is from a completely different thing that I was shooting, but I liked the shot so much that I just went to black and white, and I thought it really emblemized how you can shoot this look with a single light source. And I just put my light source in up here and hit her directly. And actually that's her head. The shadow behind her is her head because the light is just hitting her directly. I processed it out. She had this great hairdo, so it had the 40s look to it. And she had this great dress on, and I thought it was a fabulous shot. But you didn't have to use three lights or four lights or five lights. It was a single light glamour type shot. This is another one. It reminded me of Casablanca because of the trench coat and the background. This was shot with a beauty dish only, single light source. And this is a very good friend of mine. Her name is Lindsay. And we had her hair styled in the 40s style. She has a rose in one side. And I just like the fact that it has all the elements, but it's only used one light. Bibliography. I did a lot of research for this presentation because I wanted to give you more than just say, okay, this is the shot that I took, this is how I took it. Because this genre in photography has a huge social impact with the history of the country, right? We are in the Great Depression, it takes us through World War II. All right, after World War II, the entire movie industry changes dramatically. This is the heyday in the golden era of movies. This is when you can see a double feature and spend the entire afternoon in the theater and escape what was going on outside, okay? So I had an old textbook from when I was in college. I forgot to take the year of it, but it was a really great textbook, A Short History of the Movies by Mastin Cohen. This author, John Cobal, has written extensively on the genre. He probably has 5 or 6, maybe 7 books out. I happened to get a hold of these three. And they're very informative, they're very easy to read, and they're literally like a couple of pages of text and then just all photos with captions. So it's a lot to see. The great books, I took a lot of information from them. I feel it's, because it's such an important part of photographic history and social history, I thought it was important to impart that, but also that you can see elements of the genre in today's work, today's commercial work, ad work, print work. When someone, I guarantee you, when someone walks down the red carpet at the Oscars, someone's going to say about this actress, oh, she has the Hollywood glamour thing going on. And who's going to know what that is? We all are, right? It's almost ingrained into our psyche, okay? And I really enjoyed doing the research. It was a lot of fun. Thank you, and always strive to have fun, right? Relax, have fun. One of the things that I did find that when I was doing the research, and I said this before, I didn't find anybody shooting this look with speed lights, nor would anybody shooting this look with speed lights the way I do it. So I thought that was interesting too, because there's a whole new way to do it. One of the drawbacks to shooting with speed lights is there's no modeling light, so you can't see what you're going to get, right? I don't view that as a drawback. I view that as the happy accident. If you set your light, right, and you take the shot, and it's amazing, guess what? You did good. If it's not amazing, you just adjust a little bit. But it's more of an exploration of your lighting look, how you want it to end, where you can point your model. What I normally do is set my light, I'll take my initial shot, my exposure, then I'll adjust everything, and I may move around the light. Because the more she turns her head one way, the deeper shadows will go one way or the other. You may like the shot better if her shoulder is way over here, as opposed to looking into the light here. So with speed lighting, you have no modeling light. You don't know what's going to happen, but so what? This is where you say, I'm just gonna go for it and have some fun, right? You may wind up with this great shot, you never know. I highly doubt we will not get a good shot with Rochelle. She is a working professional, she is awesome. And I think we should do a quick Q&A and then we'll start shooting. Any questions? What's your name?
Nina.
Nina?
In general, what are your instructions to the makeup artist?
So Nina asked what my instructions are to the makeup artist. Okay. Usually ruby red lipstick. I always try to make sure that, this is a great question from Nina about hair and makeup. Try to keep foundation and base natural. Try to make skin tones match. So if your client or subject is wearing something off the shoulder, make sure it's not too heavy up here so that skin tone doesn't match top to bottom. That is a nightmare trying to bring that back together. Usually eyelash extensions, because you want those big eyelashes. The eyeshadow, I keep light gray maybe, not too dark, and ruby red lipstick.
And usually
like
a matte type of finish on the skin?
Yes, matte. Nina asked what kind of a finish. A matte finish and have powder on hand. Because speed lighting is very hard light. We will not be using an omnibounce. We will not be using anything on the light except the snoot. So that light is hard and fast and unforgiving. So this is why you need to have a flat finish and make sure you have powder. Because people can also oil through. I've photographed women who have oiled through all their makeup.
Yep,
any other skin, try and keep everything the same. If you use a hair and makeup artist or just a makeup artist, try to make sure that their skin tones match. I photograph people with makeup artists who have put too much foundation and base on, and this is, looks like they have got a tan from Florida, and this looks like they've been in winter, right? And that is impossible to bring back together. You're trying to desaturate this and saturate this, add bronzer to this. It's a nightmare. So you absolutely have to pay attention to that. So it's always good to have your MUA or a makeup artist on site if you can. Okay, so we're gonna have Rochelle pull up, give me a look.
Where am I facing you?
Up here.
Oh.
That alluring far away. Okay, so if you're Hedy Lamarr, it's 1940.
I've had to Google.
Rochelle had to Google who Hedy Lamarr was. Which is okay. This is okay, it's okay. Even though you look like her, it's okay. All right, so we'll make this into modern times now. We'll get out of 1940 and we'll go to 2014. So if you're looking for a star and this guy's coming around the corner and you're looking alluringly because you want him to look at you, who would it be? Yeah. Who's the man of the moment?
Joseph Gordon-Levitt. He's my favorite.
Oh, he's hot. I like him. She said Joseph Gordon-Levitt, so I'm cool with that. Right? Right? I'm cool with that. Okay, so he's over here, and you want him to recognize you. You want him to recognize not be surprised. You want him to recognize you. All right, so you're looking, you're alluring, you're... Okay, very good. Okay, she's on. We're getting there. You'll be able to see what she looks like in just a second. Okay. Oh, I'm sorry, hon.
It's okay.
So my key light is a Nikon SB910. I will turn it on, turn everything on. I'm using a Photix Odin radio trigger system. This is their TTL system. And you can also operate all your flashes in manual mode. I will be in manual mode at 1/4 power. The key to this thing is to get your light high, okay, and aim it down at a steep angle. All right, does not have to be on a 45 degree angle. We're gonna be fairly steep here. All right, I want sharp, hard shadow. I can change it later on. I think it may be a touch too steep because she's sitting so low from me. Maybe we'll open this up a little bit, right about to there, okay? Now, my light's coming down and hard, so if I have her come into that look where she's looking up, she'll be looking right up into the light, all right? So that's our key. That's our first light setup. Let's see if we can take a quick shot, and we'll set exposure. I'll turn my camera on. Make sure everything's on. Yeah, everything's turned on. Let's take a quick test shot, hon. So my key light is set to manual mode at 1/4 power. He's over here. Look longingly. Yes, darling. What a sizzling slab of man steak. Come to me. No, don't laugh. And don't laugh. Okay, we're getting there. We're getting there. What do we think? I think your head's a little too tilted up.
Yeah.
Okay. I want to bring your head down just a touch. And we are not clipping any highlights. I'm at 1/125th, an aperture of 8. All right. So I have plenty of depth of field. What I want you to do is, yep, not so high up. There we go. High just a little more. Pull your shoulders like this. There, that's it. Raise up just a touch. Perfect. Okay, now we're getting better. Okay, now she has those Joan Crawford eyelashes. Look at that, or her eyebrows rather. Really high up and arched and just beautiful. We have light coming down underneath her lip. We have some loop light on her right side of her nose. What do we think? We're getting there. All right, we are totally getting there. I want to put a little more angle on the light. I want it to be a little bit sharper on her face. So I'm going to move my light to the right just a touch. All right, and Joseph Gordon-Levitt is now over here. Here we go. See that? I don't know if I like that side on you. Do you like that side? No? Other side? Okay. You want to turn the chair around and maybe swing to me? There we go. There we go. Yeah. Now swing over. Put your hand, coat to the edge of the chair, hand on. Yep, a little bit more this way, just a touch. There we go. Paramount light. Look at what we caught. Look at the Paramount light. It's right underneath her nose, right here. See that? All right. We're getting there. We're totally getting there. I'm not sure if I'm liking my key light here. What do you guys think? I'm going to push it over to here. All right. Oh, I'm sorry. Let's try that. Now I like that better. Now I like that much, much better. All right? I want you to drop your, don't go so high. Yeah, right about to there. Here we go. Okay, now we're pulling into it. We have our initial setup. We have some beautiful hard light. We have no clipped highlights. We have great dramatic shadow on the left side of her cheek. See that? All down here. Her black top is accepting all of that light, sucking it all right back in. This will show her face. This will show everything. Let's go to black and white. And we'll give ourselves a simple black and white. Okay, now what do we see? Right? If you remove the black and white, oops, hang on. It looks totally different than when you take it to black and white. It's a whole different dynamic in the look of the photograph. Now we'll add a hair light. Normally when I add the hair light to this, I will cross light. So my key is here and my hair is here. All right, I'm this way, there's no way of getting any light onto her cheeks when she's facing this way. But we'll see how this turns out. So here, I'll be using a rogue grid. And the grid will be turned on. It's a Nikon SB800. We have a very, very tight working area. Oh, hang on. I'm not going to the grid. I'm sorry. Getting ahead of myself. Using the snoop, the large flash bender as a snoop. My fault. This has a very tight spread of light, but I want to open up her hair. I really want to open up her hair. I think right about there. This is all by eye. Okay, there's nothing, I'm not measuring, I'm just going by eye. She has this very dark chestnut colored hair, right? So I'm gonna try with manual mode at a quarter power, see if we can bring anything up. If we can't, we're going to push our power up a little bit. So we have look one going. Single light source. We've got some loop light prior to this. We have Paramount light. We have a lot going on. Ready on? Okay, hang on, let me move this light stand out of the way. Oh, didn't fire. Did it? Hang on, let me test it. I don't think it, oh, it did. It did. Okay, problem number one. I left the backlight on. But look what we got. Who's good with the happy accident? Okay, so let's take another shot without the background light, just a hair light, and we'll see what we think. There we go. I'm starting to like it. I don't think there's enough light coming down to the left side of her. Okay? It's a little too much on the top, not enough on the left side. So I have two choices here. I'm going to show you a great trick. I'm going to take the snoot and open it up just a touch. See that? And drop it down a little bit. Now I should be able to get more coverage this way. All right. My other option is, if I still don't like that, I'll remove the large flash bender, put the smaller one on. And the smaller one will still have a greater spread of light as it exits the snoot. Even though it's tight, it will come out faster like this. This is why we're getting all that great light on the foreground, right? The snoot is controlling it, but still it's coming out like this. Chin down a touch right there. What do we think now? Yep. Now I like it. Now I really like it. We have this whole thing going. Now we even opened up the background. See that? We have this big, beautiful patch of light on her head. We have that beautiful patch of light on her face. We have these great shadows. We're in black and white. I would even crop this down to a nice 8x10 to make it really fit the format later. We can get rid of some of this and just go chest to up here. Have a great shot, all right? So now we'll add light number three. We've gotten two lights so far. Are we happy so far? Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay, good. For the backlight, I'm using a rogue grid. And I think I will just shoot it right through here. Maybe not. Maybe it's kind of tight back here. There we go. Turn it on. And let's see what we get. Everything's on. Yep. I'm going to put it right behind her head, maybe hopefully hit towards that side. Okay, see it? It's on the right side of, it's actually on the left side of her head, see it? It opened up that corner. I don't want to open up that corner. I want to send it a little further. I like to open up that corner on that side of the frame, the upper right side of the frame. So we'll just adjust our light. I'll swing it over to the left a little bit. Maybe raise it up one notch. Just be careful, I may be flashing you. But it's pretty tight. It's a pretty tight spread of light. I have the Rogue Grid with both pieces in it. If you purchase or own one of these, you'll notice that you get two pieces. It goes from 25 degrees, 45 degrees, and then you can put them together for 16 degrees. And that's what I have in there now. It's a very, very tight spread of light. I'll go in close, get rid of any of the background nonsense. Did I miss the wall completely?
No.
Oh, hairlight didn't go. Hang on. Hairlight didn't go? Hang on. Let's see. Make sure everything, the batteries are plugged in, everything's working. Make sure I didn't touch anything. Oh, I did. You know that? Look at that. When I changed it, I hit the mode button and I went from TTL to RPT. Sorry about that. If you're a Canon shooter, your Canon flashes go from ETTL to M for manual. If you're a Nikon shooter, they go from ETTL to RPT to GN to AA to something else and then to manual. You have a lot of choices. So if you hit that button once, you have the opportunity to change from manual to something else by accident, which is what I did. I apologize for that. Ready, hon? Here we go. Now we're getting there, right? We have our key light with our hard, deep shadows. We have our hair light blowing out some of the top there, which is really, now we're coming into what we want with this look. And we have a background light. I think the background light for me is a touch too short, you. It's gotta go up. I think we'll go up and to the right just a little bit.
Are you still at quarter power on everything?
Let me double check that. Who was that?
Roger.
Roger, I believe I am still at quarter power. Let me double check for you. Let's see, should we go there? We'll push this up just a little bit. Yeah, right there. Yes, every flash is at one quarter power. All right, so I didn't even change the power back here. All I did was open up that flash bender and made a horseshoe. Okay, if I take the black and white off, see, it looks so different, doesn't it? Looks totally different. No clipped highlights, perfect exposure, plenty of sharp in the photo. Ready? There we have it. That's much better for me. What do you guys think? I don't even care for blowing that highlight in the back. That's more of the look. That's more of something that you would see. I kind of like it. I think, what do you think we should do to it? Push a little more to the right? I think we should push it just a touch more to the right. Right about to there. Let's try that, and we may even lower it just a touch more. Ready? Too much, just a touch too much. I think we should go back to where we were. Okay. I think this is the beauty of doing it with speed lights. is that you can adjust and play and fool around, okay? Our background's really kind of bare and blank and not really much happening to it. This is adding a third dimension to it. We have our key, our hair, and background light. Let's adjust this one more time. How about we do this? We'll take one of these out. So, okay, I'll ask you guys. I'm at 16 millimeters. It's a very tight spread of light. I can go 25 or 45. What's it going to be?
45.
45. Make sure I got the right one. 45 it is. Slip this right back into the holder. Put on the elastics so everything will stay in place. I won't hit any more buttons. And we'll try right about there. Ready? Yeah. See, just like that. It's like you're... Because he's right there behind me. How's that? Much better. Yeah, that's much, much better. Now we've actually captured almost a halo on her. All right, so we've added that effect, okay? Much, much better. The look is much better. It's more dramatic because you know he's right behind me. So this is when you begin now to pull everything together, all right? Takes a little time, but it's not all that difficult, is it? Is it difficult?
No.
No, it's not that difficult. If you own a couple of speed lights, own a couple of flash benders, you can do a lot of creative work, and that is awesome. We're getting into the, these are great. We're moving into the awesome stage. I really became enamored with Hedy Lamarr, and I think you look like her. Absolutely, with the lips, right? The nose, the structure of the face, everything. And a little known fact, which I found out, she was an inventor. Anybody know that?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, unbelievable. She, like, everything that happens today is, like, based on her invention of radio spread technology. Radio, yeah.
Cell phones,
the internet, torpedo. It was based on torpedoes. Hang on. During World War II, she was born in Austria. She emigrated here, went to work for MGM. She invented something called, hold on, I had to put it in my phone because I couldn't remember it. She invented something called spread spectrum radio with a composer whose last name was Antheil. It's known today, more known today, it's called frequency hopping. And what her idea was, torpedoes would go from point A to point B using radio frequency as their guidance system. But you could jam a radio frequency and turn the torpedo to a different direction. Which her invention was radio hopping, so the frequency would change at certain intervals. So the sender and the receiver would know the signal pattern, but the guy who tried to jam it, the jamming system could never link into the radio signal long enough to jam it. Everything is based on it.
Wow.
It's amazing. And she didn't get any recognition until like 1980, because it was classified. Really just an amazing person, right? This amazing person. Okay, now we're coming into our look. We're coming into that, right? Far away, Joseph Gordon-Levitt, he's over here. She's got the dreamy allure. Let's dissect the photo a touch. If you look, we have that beautiful backlight. It's a halo around her, okay? So with the grid, we've created our own backgrounds, if you will. We have a beautiful hair light. The hair light's moved as she's moved, but we haven't touched it yet. We have an awesome key light. We have Paramount light underneath her nose, deep shadows underneath her lower lip, and look at her eyelashes are reflecting down on the left side of her cheek, okay? I had someone say something to me about that one time, and I said, that's the look. If you look at any of the photos from that time, that light is going through and reflecting back onto the skin, okay? So we're getting there. I'm really happy. This is the point now, things are starting to come together. What I recommend is when you're shooting this kind of look now, start moving around your subject, all right? You've got your three lights set. I'm happy with how they're hitting and interacting with my subject. Rochelle is beautiful, she knows how to pose, so it's really becoming easy for me to do this. But what I want to do is I want to change things up. So I'm not going to change my lights because that begins to take too long, right? If you're doing this professionally, you have an hour sitting, you don't have a lot of time. If you're doing it in a workshop like this, I still don't have a lot of time. So what we do is we move around our light. And I try to teach this to everybody. Set your light somewhere, take your initial shot, then once you've done that, you move around. And you can change the look of your photograph as the light hits your subject as they look at you differently. Okay, so I'm gonna take a few shots. And I'm gonna move over to here, perfect. And we'll come back to here, a little more straight on, right there, perfect. Okay. How do we make out? Hang on, let me get to the second one. Look at that. That's awesome. That's really in the realm of the look, where she's leaning forward, right? Alluring. Okay, she's looking away. There is a catch light there, which I'm surprised, because a lot of times you won't find a lot of catch lights in this kind of work, because the lights are so high, right? And the light is hitting your subject so hard and down. We have some stuff in the background, but that doesn't matter, right? It almost looks like there's something there on purpose. We're not gonna tell anybody that's not there on purpose, right? Nobody knows that. No one on YouTube knows that. All right, but what I've done is I took three different shots from three different locations. She didn't move, she changed her pose a little bit. I moved around, and that's what I want to do. This makes the photograph more interesting. I love that, that's absolutely fantastic. Let's take a few more. Look over to here, right there, perfect. Down over to here, he's over here now. He's leading you on. He's the leading man. He's leading you on. Okay, not so much. A little too much for me. All right? Let's go backwards. I like that one. I like that one a lot. Even the stuff in the background, we're not going to tell anybody that's a speed light. Okay? But I like that one a lot. Remember, too, these guys are adding these kinds of elements. I'm doing it because I really have no place else to put the speed light. But you add things to make the photo look more dramatic. Let's see. That's very Joan Crawford looking. That one. I'm really digging that one. You guys, I think that's our keeper. What do you think? If you want that to be the keeper, raise your hand. Yeah, oh my God, wow, almost unanimous. That's awesome. Okay, let's take a few more shots, and then we'll choose our final keeper, and I'll show you how I process it, okay? That way you can see I use a couple different programs. I use an action set called Totally Rad Actions, and I use usually Nick software to put some glamour glow on it, give it a nice dreamy, ethereal kind of effect, all right? But I want to shoot some more because I really think that this is such a great technique that you can see how much you can do with simple equipment. All right, I came down here today. I'm from Connecticut. I have my camera roller bag with my laptop, and I had a small over-the-shoulder bag with three light stands and a small complement of Rogue flash benders, and that's it. All right, so you can always do a lot with a little. I do have the strobe lighting. I do have beautiful soft boxes. But that's, you can't carry with you all over your shoulder, right? And ride the train. Okay, let's take a few more. I'm gonna come deeper this way, a little bit closer to you. Look this way again, there we go. Yep, right there. Are we getting? Anyway, they're getting better or worse? They're getting better every time. Absolutely better every time. Okay. Now I moved over. I moved over again. Okay. I'm going to come to this way just to touch. Okay. I want you to what I want you to do is kind of put your arm on the chair and lean a little bit out this way. There we go. Now what I want to do is I'm going to have her lean and turn to me and see if we can't use some of this hair light on the side of her face. Turn to me this way. He's over here now. What do we think of that? I don't like that one too much, do you? No. I'm not too big with the second light. I think it's too horror lighting. That's a lot. That's Frankenstein light, man. That's really too much. All right? That's really too much on her. If we go back, we were in the more classic realm here. So we're going to forget that look. But I'm going to have you lean that way, but just look, that's the ticket right there. Over there. Yeah, mouth open just a touch. And I'm going to come here. No, you're too deep to me. Down a bit. There we go. That's a good one. I'm really happy. That's a good one, isn't it? That's really a great one. I want to try that again. I don't want you to be too steep on your head. I'm going to come, yeah, just a little more, a little straighter up on, that's it. Wow. Okay, hang on. Now we're getting into the shoot. Now we start to get into the shoot. I'm going to come over to here. Now look to me on right there. Perfect. Get right there. I think the one before.
Yeah.
Totally. Totally. I don't even care about the thing in the back. Look at that. We can crop that out, go right down to 8x10, take that right down. Okay, let's take a few more shots, then we'll start the image selection and processing. Yep. Well, that one's very dark. Look how deep and dark that one is. Okay? That's really deep and dark. I'm going to pull her more into the light. What do you guys think? Do you want
like
it?
That.
Like that?
Yeah.
You like that? I'm all about that. That's my kind of look. I love that deep, right?
Is it okay that the corner of her mouth gets lost in the shadow?
That's fine with me.
Other ones were nice too, but at the corner.
What's your name?
Badge.
Badge? Mm-hmm. So Badge wants to know if it's okay if the corner of her mouth gets lost in the shadow. I'm going to ask the class, what do you guys think?
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Yeah. Don't let yourself be, don't let yourself ever be contained by any convention. Okay? If someone says to you the photograph absolutely has to have a catch light, if someone said that to me, you know what that means to me? Now I have to go photograph someone with no catch light. Right? I just have to do it. If you look at any of these photos from the 30s and 40s, you'll find a lot of these photos don't have catch lights in them. The reason for that is when she gives me the joist, he's right behind me, but down here. So don't look up into the light. Look down here. Okay, where's the catch light? There isn't one, because the light's so high. Because the shadows are so strong and deep, a lot of the light is up here. Right. When she looks up, you'll see the catch light. But if some, but bless you, sorry. Don't get hung up in the conventions. Right. Do things, learn them, learn the proper thing to do, then go off on a tangent. Go have fun. Because if your client likes it, guess what? They're going to write you a check. And hopefully it'll clear. If they really like it, they'll clear. And I'm that way. Like personally, if you said to me, that photo absolutely has to have the left side of that mouth, I guarantee you I would choose that photo just because it didn't, you know? Or if you said to me had to have a catch light, I would definitely shoot it without one, just to do it. But don't get lost in those conventions. Learn them, learn the right thing to do, then break all the rules, right? Because your best shot ever could be the one that isn't what you think it's supposed to be, you know? Okay, let's take a couple more, then we'll go to processing, then we'll wrap it up, we'll be right on schedule. All right, so where do we like our, we took a lot of photos. Yeah, I like that. Now that pulled the arm in.
Nice.
That's nice. That's really classic. Okay. What I want you to do is pull the arm in again, but don't put the palm too far up. There we go. All right. Look at that. You could just stay here for hours and it would just get better and better and better. All right. Yeah, perfect, just like that. I really like this angle. I like how the light's coming around. Drop the right hand completely, yep. Okay, just coming up, just coming out. I think I like that one better. You guys?
Yep.
Okay, look at the hard shadows. Look at the shadows under her fingers. Do we care? No, we don't care, because it's an awesome headshot. Look at that. That is like perfect. We've got the great catch light. We've got the hand here. We've got the look. She's dreamy. She's got the eyebrows, like the Joan Crawford eyebrows, the whole thing going on. And that's really a classic kind of pose, okay, for this style. I always try to avoid like doing this, all right, because I'm not in third grade anymore. And she's leaning forward and looking up and coming around to me. I like that one too, without the hand, you know. What time is it? 2? Okay. We're getting to the point where we should start processing a photo. So I'm going to run. I got a great tip on Sunday from a photographer who was at my workshop. And he learned from somebody, but he didn't remember who. He said when you... this gal told him that when you start to do your selects, your finals, after you've done your shoot, go backwards. Look at all your photos backwards. So instead of starting at number 1 and going to number 50, start at 50 and go back to number 1 and choose your selects that way. He says you'll look at your photos differently than doing the opposite way, because that's how you know you took them, right? So I'm going to say let's try that. What do you guys think?
Sure.
All right, let's rock on. I'll turn the trigger off. I'm going to turn my camera off. I'm going to move this light out of the way. You can have a seat back there, hon. Just relax. Yeah, I'll get this out of the way. Okay. So how are we going to do this? You should just give me a yes, shout out yes, or shout out no. What do you guys think?
Yes.
Okay, I like this one. What do you say?
Yes.
That was easy. All right, let's go. Wait, man, I got to write this down. Okay, that was the last one in the set. This one?
Yes.
Oh, you guys are killing me. That one?
Yes.
No. No. No.
No.
I like that, but not yet.
No.
No. Although I like the dramatic light. That's a maybe?
Maybe.
No. I like that one.
Yeah.
That's a really classic look. That one? No. No, that's horror light. No.
Yes.
Yes. Yes for that one?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, hang on. Let's go back to that one. I like that one.
Yes.
I'm digging. I don't know. We really liked that one before. Hang on.
Yes.
Yes. That's one we chose earlier. What do you guys think?
Yes.
Talk to me.
Yes.
No? Who said no?
She's voted down.
I kind of like that one. It looks like she's in the studio on the right side. Okay. Hard light. You're missing the left part of the lips. But you have that hard, deep shadow. We have a little catch light. Okay. What do you guys think? No?
No.
Keep going. Yes to that one?
Yes.
I don't know. That one? No, I'm liking the ones in the back better. Let's go down to that last one. I'm digging that one. You guys?
Yeah.
Who wants this one?
Yeah.
All right, well, this is number 2321. 2321. Hang on.
Yeah.
I like that one. 2332? No? Oh, no, I know which one. That one? This one?
Yeah.
I don't know if I like the palm.
Oh, yeah.
I like that one?
Yeah.
I really like that one. This one?
Yeah.
Let's go with this one. Okay, so unanimous, we're going this one?
Yes.
All right, good show. What do you, well, now we're all choosing for our model. What do you think? We should totally include this talent in the decision process. All right, we're not going to tell anybody what's in the left corner, right? We don't even know what that is down there. That was put there on purpose to add some drama to the lower left corner of the frame. All right, so we'll process this out to make this quick. I will set this as a regular basic JPEG. All right. And we will process this one out as a JPEG. So just give it a second to go.
Is that the last one?
No, it is the last one we took, is it? No, it's not. It's not. Let's see. It is the last one we took. Okay, a lot of photographers will tell you it's either the first frame or the last frame, right? I mean, come on, it's like unbelievable. All right, so we'll get out of Capture One. Oh, by the way, I use Capture One Pro 7. I don't use Lightroom. My initial goal was to go to a medium format later on in my career, so I decided to stick with this software. And this is supported by Phase One, so that's my camera of choice when I win the lottery. Because they just released a new digital back. Let's find this photo and go to work. Okay, I'm going to pull this photo down and we are going to go into Photoshop. I will be using Photoshop, CS3. Yeah, I'm in 3. I prefer 3. I don't like the content aware. That drives me crazy. When that thing is next to it, trying to, oh my God, it just drove me crazy. So I use Photoshop 3 a lot. I have 3 and 5. I go in between the two. Okay, so we swapped this to black and white already. We have a very nice, simple, desaturated black and white, desaturated color image to black and white. Come on. All right, there it is. That's a very classic, very simple, very elegant look. First thing we're going to do is what? What would you guys do first? Since we already have a black and white, what should we do?
Copy the background.
What's that?
Copy the background.
Copy the background? Okay, we do Control J, we copy the background. All right, we do all our work on top of our initial layer, right? Our initial photograph. Okay. It's sharp, it's perfect, it's beautiful. I'm going to bring it up just a touch to check for sharpness. I think we're covered on sharpness, you guys? Okay. If you're a Nikon shooter, the 105 f2 is literally like a macro lens. It is made for portrait work. If you look at her skin, it is almost utterly perfect. There's like no, there are no pimples to remove, there's no, yeah. There's barely anything to remove at all except to start softening. There may be one little blemish we'll take out. Let's take a look. There are some pores up here. I guess everybody has to have a pore or two. We spot healing brush, and we'll take out that one little piece right there. And there's a little one around down here. And let's see. So we do a quick spot heal. Get rid of any of the imperfections that we see. Okay, very simple. If you look at the eyelashes, look at that shadow on the eyelash there. Isn't that awesome?
Yeah.
It is so awesome.
Yeah.
Right? Everything is clean. Everything is sharp. I shot it at f8, so there's plenty of detail to work with. Look at, now when you shoot at f8, you also have to remember that the closer you are to your subject, the shallower depth of field gets. Look how fast depth of field falls off beyond her face. Okay, let's see. Bring this down a touch. If you look at the photo, her face is sharp to right about here. And right about here, where her hair begins, the hair is a little bit sharp and then it starts to fall off. All right, if this were a 200 millimeter lens, it would be a little bit shallower even. You would get enough detail on the face, but your depth of field would start to come forward just a touch. So that's great. That's perfect for me. We will do skin first. We'll do a very quick skin soften and smooth over. I go to the action palette. I have to drag it down, sorry. All right, I use a process from Totally Rad Actions called Portrait Retouch version 2. It is all right here in the colored boxes. In your action palette, you have two choices. You can set it to these action bars, or you can set it back to where you normally has that look where you have to click on it and then click the action to run it. Here you just click it and it runs. So I'm going to start with foundation light right here. Box will come up. This is what we're going to do. You just say yes. It will create a complete softening effect for you. What I like about this is it's all done in layers. So you paint out the layer, paint out your effect, and you go on to the next layer.
So the action's adding all those layers.
It's doing everything for me. Okay. Now I'll grab my, I have my paintbrush already. I'm going to increase the size of the paintbrush. And I'm going to do this very quickly. Soften her skin right out. Under the eyes, right? All down through here. Over the nose, right? You begin to see how soft it got suddenly? I'm going to go just to the edge of the hair to blend in the skin. I'll drop my brush down. I'll do above the eyelashes, just in this little section right here. Okay. So I've immediately begun to bring us into that realm. All right. I want to do a little more, I think, because her forehead's just a touch too hot for me. What do you guys think?
Yes.
We're softening up just a touch more. So I'm going to go down to foundation medium. It says this is what we're going to do. You say yes. We'll soften her up just a little bit more. The thing is, all this is happening for you. You just paint the action out, and then you're all done. If you don't like it, you just drag and drop the layer to the trash. Okay, let's do that to her skin again. I'll make the brush a little bit bigger. Oh, here we go. See that? Now we're into where we are in 1941. And Hedy Lamarr is sitting in front of us. See, look how it smooths that edge there? That contrast change, okay? Right over the nose, here we go. I'm gonna drop this right down into where her, into this area here and soften that right up. Okay, just along the edge of her chin. All right, let's back this down just a touch so we get a fuller view. Look how so much softer she is already. I'm going to keep that hard edge shadow. That's what I want. I want that hard edge shadow. So we've got a softening already going, right? We're almost done, actually, right? We have to add some glamour glow, and maybe we'll pull up the lips just a touch. So I'm going to pull the lips up, I think. Actually, let's go up. We'll open up the eyes. We'll make the eyes just a touch brighter. And I will slide down to iris lightener right here. I hit enter because that's what I want. And I'll bring my brush down in size. And I'll make her eyes just a touch brighter. Just a touch. And then we'll go to luscious lips. See if we can pull those lips up just a little bit. Oops, missed it. Oh, sorry. Make it a little more pouty. I think it's a little bit too bright for me. What do you guys think?
Yeah.
Just a touch too bright. So we'll bring that brightness down. brightness down. Yeah, I think we'll go back to where we started from. So I didn't like luscious lips, so I'll take that layer and drop that down to the trash can. And that's good. I think her lips are good right where they are. Let's give her some fuller eyelashes. We'll brighten up her hair just a touch. Then we'll add a nice glamour glow. Right, give it that glowy, ethereal, warm look. So we go to dramatic lashes right here. I'll click that. I'll run the action. This will help to make her lashes a little fuller, right? A little sharper. Oh, they're sharp enough already. I paint that right over the lashes. You see it happen. Let's see, let's go. Make those lashes really shine. Look at that. All right, because it's all about that. Maybe we'll add this to the eyebrows. Bring the eyebrows up just a little bit. Okay. And we'll do brunette shine. She's a brunette. What color is your hair on? It's like a chestnut, isn't it? She just had her hair done for us. Yeah. That's a professional. So we'll bring up some highlights in the hair because we have all that great light hitting it. Might just add a little touch of drama right to there, even a little halo around. Okay. I'm almost thinking Sophia Loren. Anybody? Yeah. All right. Now we'll go to Glamour Glow, and that we're almost done. So I'm not going to flatten the layer. I'm going to put a layer on top of this. So I'll hit the Shift key, Shift, Alt, Control, and the letter E. I'll make a new layer. Now I go to my filter menu, and I use Nix software. Anybody have Nix software? If you don't, take a hard look at it. It's really great software. It'll pull this into it. And I'll go to the left and I will choose Glamour Glow. What do we think now? Yeah, I'm digging now. I'm really digging, are you? Okay, so my Glamour Glow is set to 50%. All right, you can push it down to, you can push it up where it's insane, or push it down where it's just slightly less. I think we'll slightly less. We'll go to 25. I usually head around 25 is the number.
Like 35.
35? Who wants that 25, 35, or 50?
35.
Let me just grab the slider. I think that's it. I think you guys are right. That is it right there. Okay. Let's see. I don't know if I can. No, hang on. There we have it. All right, I think I was just in my final retouch and the final analysis, I would go back with the healing brush, take out some of those stray hairs in the upper right corner, and we have our 40s glamour portrait, right? And then after that, after I take out those stray hairs, I'd probably crop it to maybe 8x10. So if we get the crop tool, our width will be 8, our height will be 10. And there it is. What do we think? It was awesome, wasn't it? It was awesome. I absolutely love that. It's absolutely perfect. It's beautifully retouched in a matter of how long? A minute? 2 minutes? Right? We banged that out. Went right through the entire process. Okay, who do we think? So I thought Hedy Lamarr. Then I'm looking at Sophia Loren at the moment. Sophia Loren. Yeah, most definitely. She's even dressed fashionably as an Italian actress should be. Okay, Let's see, let's get out of the crop tool. I don't want to crop this, do I? No. Don't crop. I will not crop right now because I want to take out those. Actually, I'll show you guys a trick with the healing brush tool. I don't know if you guys know this or not. I recently just discovered this. Look at that. It even looks like a negative that's been airbrushed, right? Get rid of the action palette here. Okay. I found this great thing to do with the healing brush, or clone stamp rather. Hit the clone stamp, right? Go up here. I was doing some skin retouching before, so we'll go back to normal. Set your flow. Set your flow to like 10%, 11%. Then when you do your healing brush, you're not taking everything out all at once. You're kind of just choosing sections to softly remove the hair. Resample. You know, you want to leave some of this hair, because I think one of the things that happens is that you want to make the person look like they are. And there's always a stray flyaway hair. You don't want the one going, you know, out to Alaska. That one's got to come out, because you're not going to Alaska. But you want to make it look like there's hair there, okay? So if I paint gently and keep the hair there, but just take away some of the sharpness, sample multiple times the whole area, and we are finished. What do we think? We went from one light to two to three, all right? We use speed lights. So what did we get with the speed light? We got happy accidents, right? One light wasn't where it's supposed to be, but you know what? It didn't look all that bad. One light was where it's supposed to be, and it looked even better. We went from one to three. We posed our model. I worked around her. Don't always just stand here. There's actually an X on the floor here of gaffer tape. If she were to sit there and you set three lights up, don't always just stand there and shoot from here. Move around. And when you move around, she can move with you, but the light interacts with that person differently every time. You don't have to change exposure, right? Because your light's exposure set. She's set in one place. She just rocks, turns around. She can put her hand on the back of the chair where she did. Here she's leaning a little forward and has that forward movement going, right? She's ready to bolt out of the door because Joseph Gordon-Levitt's right over here. Right? She's like, I am out of here. Okay? Everything worked for us here, and it really worked very well. I'm very happy and pleased. Are you guys?
Yes.
Who's going to go home and try this? You can do this with strobe lighting. You can do this with constant lighting. You can do this just about any kind of light. I have yet to use my strobe light on this. I would probably use a lot of grids. If I were strobe lighting this, I would be using grids and barn doors. To control the light, which is what they used, right? Mostly a lot of barn doors. You can take the barn door and close it and really close down the light, make a strip light out of it. You can do a lot with the barn door. But I would probably be using like a 20-degree grid on her face, 30-degree grid on her face. You always want to try and contain that light. You want it to be hard and the light should be sharp, okay? These are barehead speed lights. That's a barehead speed light in that Rogue flash bender. And that light is hard, and it's fast, and it's incredibly unforgiving, okay? So someone who's not perfect like Rochelle, you'd have to do a little more work in Photoshop. But, I would probably do one or two more things to this, and that's about it. I'm very happy with this. This will go online tomorrow. This is what we did at B&H Photo yesterday, you know? It's a great shot. She has a great pose, great look. And that's it. Great, thank you very much.
Whether you're a hobbyist or a professional, B&H has the answers to your questions. Experience a world of technology at our New York City Superstore. Connect with us online or give us a call. Our staff of experts is happy to help.